What is the hemoglobin A1C and how can you lower this test overnight? Based on new research, you will find out the limits and the true accuracy of this test. Are there unknown factors that can falsely drive up the numbers, which skew the relationship between the A1C values and the average blood sugar levels? Because our doctors base their treatment and their diagnosis on this critical, critical test, you need to know all the factors that influence this test. So today, you'll get that all-important list. But before we begin, let me welcome all of you resilient diabetics out there. This is the channel we turn ordinary struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you don't know who I am and you are brand new to this channel, I welcome you. My name is Jay Sampat, and I am an insulin-dependent diabetic diagnosed a little over 6 years ago, so the proud owner of a pancreas that has gone on a permanent and lifelong vacation. So not only am I diabetic just like you, where we will be walking that walk and talking the talk together, but I do also have a University of Bachelor of Science degree in nutrition dietetics, and that comes in very handy in helping discuss all the intricacies of being a diabetic. My goal is to put 4 years of chemistry, biochemistry, organic chemistry, and human physiology into about a 10-minute or so presentation so that you know how your diabetic body works better than, dare I say, your doctor? I just did. The unique information presented today will only be found here on The Resilient Diabetic. New, life-changing episodes are generally released weekly. So if you want to learn more and you want to be notified by YouTube that a new video has been published, then the only way to do that is to first hit that subscribe button followed by the gray notification bell. Then you have to choose turn on all notifications. And of course, if you liked what you saw and heard today, please smash that like button for me. So let's start off with what is the hemoglobin A1C and how does it work? Your blood is full of red blood cells. Red blood cells contain a protein called hemoglobin, which basically carries oxygen throughout your body. Blood glucose, or basically sugar, travels through the blood and then ends up binding with the hemoglobin. When the two come together, they create what's known as the hemoglobin A1C, also known as the glycosylated hemoglobin A1C. So why is this test used? Well, first and foremost, it actually doesn't require any fasting. Two, it gives a big picture of blood sugar levels over a period of weeks to months instead of just a single moment in time like your fasting blood sugars. Third, the test can be done at any time of the day, so this makes things easier for doctors to treat and to make accurate diagnosis. Your A1C is written in percentage and gives you an idea of how well managed your blood sugar levels are over a period of 2 to 3 months. It is also one of the major factors used to diagnose pre-diabetes and diabetes. An A1C below 5.7 is considered to be normal. An A1C between 5.7 to around 6.3 to 6.4% signals pre-diabetes. Type 2 diabetes is diagnosed when an A1C is over 6.4 to 6.5%. Your A1C goal will be specific to you and to you and your doctor. Several factors will come into play, such as your age, how advanced the diabetes is, and other health conditions that you may have. A common A1C goal for people with diabetes is generally less than 7%, depending again on your doctor. Some see an A1C between 7 and 8 as reasonable and beneficial for most patients with type 2 diabetes. Others, however, want a much, much tighter control through both a lifestyle and diet changes. When I was first misdiagnosed as a type 2 diabetic, my original doctors wanted my A1C as low as possible, the high 4s to the low 5s. Once I got the right test done to confirm the latent autoimmune attack on my pancreas due to a severe gluten allergy attack I had, I was then retyped as a type 1 for all practical purposes, or a type 1.5 LADA if you like, and my new endocrinologist wanted a much, much higher A1C. So you can see, even with me, the multiple doctors I had all wanted different targets based on the diagnosis and or the misdiagnosis. So what is the undeniable truth? Those of us with diabetes who want to live a long and healthy life and avoid all the complications associated with diabetes will need to keep our blood sugar levels as normal and as stable as possible. And that is what this channel is all about. The first very important point I want to make is that you need to understand that lowering your A1C levels is a gradual process, and you will find out why. This means it can take up to 3 months to notice significant changes. This value, point blank, contrary to what anyone has said or what you may have read on the internet, cannot be manipulated overnight. So what are the unknown limitations of this test, and where can things go wrong? Because the A1C is used as the benchmark for diagnosis and treatment, progress has been made over the years in standardizing and improving the accuracy of this test. The first thing you should know is that the results from non-certified labs may not be as reliable. Depending on the machine, a single A1C test can have up to a 0.5% margin of error, which means the true value might be 0.5% higher or lower than the measured A1C value. For example, if a lab report shows an A1C of 8.0%, the actual A1C value might range from 7.5 to 8.5%. And I'll actually give you a personal example. Now, I personally use two different labs, one through my doctor and my healthcare insurance program, and a separate private lab I frequent to get all of my tests done, all my health markers done, including my A1C. Within 1 week of each other, one test gave me an A1C of 5.7 and the other a 5.3. So the second important point I want to make is to look at the overall trend over time. Do not obsess over the specific numbers. That will drive you crazy. The relationship between A1C values and average blood sugar levels can also vary markedly from person to person. In studies, using continuous glucose monitors, 24/7 blood sugar levels can be compared to a measured A1C result. The studies reveal considerable variation from person to person. For instance, an 8.0 A1C value in one person could reflect an average blood sugar of around 140 milligrams a deciliter, while in another, it could be 220 milligrams a deciliter. This variation relates to the individual differences in how our red blood cells and red blood sugars bind, or the lifespan of red blood cells. The main problem is that there's actually a wide variation in how long red blood cells survive in different people. What has the latest research found? The lifetime of a hemoglobin cell for diabetics turn over in as few as 81 days, while they live as long as 146 days in non-diabetics. This proves the assumption that everyone's red blood cells live for 3 months is not quite accurate. And second, the hemoglobin A1C can't be relied upon as a quote-unquote absolute perfect blood sugar marker. In persons with normal blood sugars, hemoglobin will be around a lot longer, which means it will accumulate more sugar. This will skew and show higher A1C test results. But it doesn't mean that person had too much sugar in their blood. It just means their hemoglobin lived longer, thus accumulated more sugars. What else would need to be considered when factoring in test results? Certain types of untreated anemias can falsely raise your A1C test numbers. Anemia is caused by the lack of iron, vitamin B12, and folate. Your body needs these vitamins and minerals to create new, healthy red blood cells and replace the older dying ones. If your body isn't making new red blood cells, that means you have more older ones around, and they're floating around, which includes ones that have already picked up more glucose. Now that we know some basics on the test and what can influence the test, let's talk about the major internal factor that will impede, if not hinder, all the steps you may correctly take in trying to improve your A1C. In previous life-altering episodes, we talked about the known causes of diabetes, which is the buildup of fats inside the muscle, inside the liver, and up and around the internal organs. This fat then creates insulin resistance, which becomes a driver of beta cell failure, resulting in continuous hyperglycemia or high blood sugars. So another way of explaining this very, very important physiological process is The high amounts of fats floating in the blood are actually coming from excessive carbs that are being consumed. It is then our livers that are converting these excessive carbs into triglycerides. The triglycerides then create resistance for insulin, which then creates high circulating insulin levels. Years of the pancreas beta cells having to pump out ever-increasing more, higher and higher amounts of insulin then just basically burns out the pancreas. It gets worn out and tired. But another important point to factor in is that all this occurs over years, sometimes decades, preceding a diagnosis. So what do recent studies show? Beta cell function declines on average of 5% per year in people with uncontrolled diabetes. Even though this decline in beta cell function starts several years before the diagnosis of type 2 diabetes, the trajectory of damage generally changes dramatically 2 years before diagnosis, reflecting what's known as acute beta cell decomposition. So by the time of diagnosis, 50% of beta cell functioning has already been lost for many, many diabetics. So what does this physiological process have to do with the A1C? Well, what took years and decades to disrupt the body will also take time to unwind and to heal. Again, one must put things into perspective and be patient with A1C changes. Knowing this, the correct tests need to be done to determine pancreatic functioning over time. The two tests that are important, as I've mentioned before, is the C-peptide test, which is used to monitor insulin production in the body, and the second test, which was critical for me, which is known as the GAD antibody test. This test will help determine if one is a type 1, or as many now call a type 1.5 LAD diabetic, such as myself, over a type 2 diabetic. The antibody test shows if the body has actually attacked its own pancreas rather than what's happened in a type 2 diabetic where burnout occurs. So two things have to occur for your A1Cs to move and move in the right direction so the body's able to start healing itself. First, if you're a type 2 diabetic, your beta cells need rest, which allows them to reestablish themselves over time. Two, the removal of all those triglycerides, the fats that have been stored up in the muscle, the liver, and around the organs, they have to be reversed and removed. And how do we do that? It's first done through our diet. Carbs, especially densely packed carbs, both good and bad, have to be limited. If you've been following me, and I know you are, and I know you are subscribed, you already know the details of this all-important point. You know how to initiate the game plan. Second, exercise. Now, here's something very critical to understand. Upon diagnosis, one has to account for the impaired pancreatic functioning as we have just discussed, thus low insulin output. Exercise, one has to remember, is a stressor depending on the exercise, the duration, and the intensity, meaning the body will release stress hormones driving up blood glucose, thus the need for insulin to bring those numbers back down. But as you know now, because there's still some significant resistance and poor insulin production, exercise initially may work against you, thus raising your A1C levels. This is why it's critical to have a doctor, especially an endocrinologist, by your side when lifestyle changes occur. Because what may happen initially is the need for insulin therapy. So insulin, usually a basal insulin, is given, which allows for both glucose control and at the same time, for beta cells to rest, which then can over time come back stronger and better for a type 2 diabetic. What is the important take-home message? If one is going to start an exercise program at first, keep it to very light, moderate, easy, gentle, brisk walks if possible. The other known factors that will influence your A1C levels? First, your ability to manage stress. Just like exercise, your body will pump out stress hormones, but unlike exercise where it's isolated to a short time frame, stress will have your body produce these very negative catabolic hormones all day long, thus continuous high blood sugar levels. Second, sleep. And not getting good sleep again will absolutely hinder your progress. You have to learn to stick to a schedule or a routine. Eating too much or too often can raise your blood sugar levels or cause them to fall excessively, thus putting more pressure on your pancreas. What I do is I eat basically the same things at around the same time each and every day. This makes things much easier to control my blood sugars. Also, weight loss. Since everyone has different structures, weight loss is specific to you as an individual. A simple weight reduction of even 5 to 7% may be enough to lower the pressure put on the pancreas, thus better output of insulin for greater blood sugar control and a well-controlled A1C over time. I'll create a very important playlist for you on more videos related to blood sugar control and the foods we as diabetics can eat or drink. In the list, start with vegetables for diabetics, top three picks. What are the best vegetables for diabetics? I'll not only give you my three top picks, but more importantly, the criteria used to determine that list. Specific videos on bananas and watermelon. Can we eat fruits as diabetics? What about those quote-unquote healthy carbs our experts say are good for us, like oats and sweet potatoes? You will now know what my everyday staple of carbohydrate sources are that easily keep my sugars low and a controlled A1C in and around the mid to low fives. But most importantly, aids in keeping me strong and energetic all day long. If you're on a desktop or laptop, use your mouse to click that box. If you're on your mobile device, tap that with your fingers. The first is the link to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channels. The second is the link to the playlist mentioned on foods. So I want you to have a great and productive day, and we'll see you soon with another new episode, which I've said are always released weekly. Bye for now.